समस्त जन कल्याणे निरतं करुणामयं नमामि चिन्मयं देवं सद्गुरुं ब्रह्मविद्वरम्। वसुदेवसुतं देवं कंसचाणूरमर्दनं देवकी परमानंदं कृष्णं वंदे जगद्गुरुं कृष्णं वंदे जगद्गुरुं।
Today we start with verse number 4, and since this is a catechetical knowledge, which is question and answer, so the question we remember, the question was that if you think that Gyan Yoga is better than Karma Yoga, then why are you instigating me to into Karma Yoga? Why are you asking me to fight? Now, so then here, the Lord has begun to answer, and he explains to him, Na karmana manarambha neshkarmyam purushoshnute na cha sanyasana deva siddhim samadhi gacchati. He says, not by non-performance of action does man reach actionlessness, nor by mere renunciation does he reach perfection. Now see, not by non-performance of action. Because Arjun then begins to think that is it that the goal of the perfect man is non-performance of action? Perfection you require if you don't do anything. But that is a very, very ridiculous sort of a goal of perfection. And any highly intellectual person is going to wonder that what kind of Vedantic goal is this? And if this is what Hinduism's highest goal is, then it's worth discarding. That the highest goal is when you become actionless. Now Krishna here says, not by non-performance of action. He very clearly is saying that it is not by non-performance of action does man reach actionlessness. So what is the way to reach actionlessness? If that is the highest goal, then what is the way to reach it? And then he was saying non-performance of action. You see, it's a very, very interesting thing. And it is looks paradoxical, seems paradoxical, but there is a lot of thought that has gone into this. Unless you eliminate total desires or total desires have gone from you, you cannot be actionless. Man is born to act. We have indriyas called karmendriyas in Vedanta. Arms, legs, you know, your whole body works. Your mouth, your tongue, everything has got a work, definite work. And not even a moment can you live without doing any action. So he says here that it is just not possible that you do not work. So worklessness is a term which is very, very widely misunderstood by readers of the Gita. People just start reading the Gita. So without understanding the Vedantic philosophy, they understand it as idleness, a kind of a stupor you go into, or a drug you take, or eternal sleep. Is that the goal? So that could definitely, definitely not be goal and not be the goal. So this is misunderstood. Now, so then what is it? So we need to dig over here. And it is that, see, unless and until all your desires are fulfilled, you cannot reach Neshkarmyam. Neshkarmyam Siddhi, it's called a Siddhi. That means you acquire that perfection. But even if you have a single desire in you, you cannot be Neshkarmya. Because with desire, you will work towards it. You will run towards it. It is natural. It has to happen. If you feel incomplete, you will run to complete it. Okay, so it is only there are unending desires we have, and piled up from generations and generations, or rather lives and lives, not generations, lives and lives that we have lived, there has been this desire and that desire stored up. So there are mountainous desires in us. Now, how do those desires go? Unless and until you understand the futility of desires, desire will not go. And so over here it is, see, ignorance is expressed as desire, ignorance of your full nature, your complete nature, which does not have any lack of anything, which does not need anything to fulfill itself. The ignorance of that completeness causes desire. You always desire something which you do not have, isn't it? So we all feel, I don't have this, I don't have that. And we have to just look at something to feel that I should have it. You look at a beautiful flower somewhere in a park and you want to pluck it and bring it home. What is that? Why don't you just see it and admire it as beautiful over there? But you want to possess it. So this is a human temperament. And he says that that is what causes desires. Desires cause thoughts. Now carefully, there cannot be a single thought if there is no desire. And thoughts, if there are even one thought, it will prompt you into action. It will propel you into action. So desire, ignorance, then desire, then thoughts, and they go into actions. So here it is that unless and until these things keep getting eliminated one after the other, you will never reach this stage. But then how to reach it? The question is that if we always have going to have desires, then why? Why do you think that this thoughtless action will ever come? Life of actionlessness, neshkarmyam, as it is called in this verse. Neshkarmyam. So how do you reach neshkarmyam? Neshkarmyam is not reached by running away from action in life. You have to perform action. If you have taken a body, propelled by the desires of that body, you will commit actions. Now, so then don't be foolish enough to think that neshkarmyam can be reached by actionlessness. It cannot be. Ram Sukh Das Ji has said it very nicely, and I am quoting it for you. In the material world, you progress by action. Look at this. In the material world, you progress by action. And in the spiritual world, through inaction, but arrived at through action. Interesting. When you act to fulfill desires, supposing you have had too much of that desire satisfaction, doesn't it drop? You do not want it anymore. Just like I give an example of a rasgulla. First rasgulla, very desirous. You want to have it. Second, okay, a little more. Third, fourth, fifth. Then slowly, slowly it starts becoming a pain to have more. And if somebody forces the 11th rasgulla on you, how disturbing is that? You will just throw it away. You will say, just no way do I want it. I am absolutely not in for it, isn't it? And the same way that vasanas, if you can exhaust the remaining vasanas you have and slowly, slowly learn the art of not acquiring more, it is only through that action that you ultimately go to neshkarmyam. That is the actionlessness. Don't forget always that Arjuna is being advised action. He is a man of action. And Krishna does not tell him to go into the Himalayas and sleep. He is asking him that fight. Now fighting is ghor action, isn't it? So how can you translate this like this, that Krishna is advising actionlessness? Actionlessness is the ultimate that happens, and nobody can be actionless unless until you have even a small single desire. So running away from the field of life, running away from the battlefield of life is not the answer. And we very clearly understand that it is not the answer. You are propelled to action. You will act. It is now the choice of actions that you make that will slowly, slowly determine your evolutionary rise. If you do ignoble actions, you will devolve rather than evolving. If you are doing noble actions, selfless actions, you will slowly, slowly evolve. And that is the way to go to this. So don't come to this hasty conclusion that Naishkarmyam is the goal of life and we should reach that. It is not the goal of life of everybody. You cannot. And as I told you, that you have mountains and mountains of desires in you, you have to first exhaust those desires. And to exhaust those desires, the path is action. You cannot do without action. So all of us generally, action, selfless action is the way to purify the mind. So Krishna will advise Arjuna karma yoga. Karma yoga is selfless, noble actions for the good of the community, in which you fulfill yourself also, you purify your mind also, your mind settles to a very great calm, and you also go on acquiring the things that you desire to acquire. So those vasanas slowly go away from you. Now come to the next verse.
नहि कश्चित् क्षणपि जातु तिष्ठत्य कर्म कृत कार्यते ह्यवश कर्म सर्व प्रकृति जैर्गुणे है.
I'll do it again.
नहि कश्चित् क्षणपि जातु तिष्ठत्य कर्म कृत कार्यते ह्यवश कर्म सर्व प्रकृति जैर गुणे है.
प्रकृति जैर गुणे है. प्रकृति बोर्न गुणास. जय मीन्स बोर्न ऑफ. प्रकृति जय गुण. सो हियर ही सेज वेरिली नन कैन एवर रिमेन इवन फॉर अ मोमेंट विदाउट परफॉर्मिंग एक्शन. For everyone is made to act helplessly indeed by the qualities born of Prakriti. This is a universal law. Each human being has to act. Eating is action. Breathing is action. Drinking is action. Defecating is action. Or there are so many actions. And if you cannot speak about yourself without using a verb, there are continuously, and verb is a word of action. So unless the pressure of your vasanas, the pressure of your desires will make you act in the world. And nobody, he says, nobody can ever remain for even a moment without performing action. Right? So total inactivity is the, Gurudev says, is the lang is the signature of death upon life. If nothing moves, if you behave like a stone, aren't you dead matter? So that is not what life is about. Life is about action. Life is about being active. No living organism, not even a small germ or an amoeba, can stay without action. So movement or action is the signature of life on any being. Therefore, he says, you cannot at all be without action. Now, if you try to even if you try, you know, some people in haste try this out, misunderstanding this these verses, they say, okay, we will suddenly jump to inactionless. So they go and sit by the Ganges like a stone and pretend to be meditating. How long can they sit like that, Timmy? Won't he get up to eat? Won't he lie down to sleep? Won't he get up to drink and eat? He will. He is breathing all the time. Even that is action. So how can you reach this stage? It is not possible. You just cannot stay without working. You have to work. You have to, even if he is not earning, even if the Mahatma sitting on the banks of the Ganges is not earning, not cooking his food, he will go out to beg his food. He has to survive, isn't it? And that is action. Going out to beg your food is action, isn't it? So, over here, the right attitude of mind is advised to a person who has to act. You and I have to act. We are people of action. But with what motivation we act, with what attitude we act, will determine whether we acquire more vasanas or we eliminate vasanas. Slowly, slowly we do away with them, or slowly, slowly we acquire more and more and more. So it should not become cyclical, that you go in for elimination and you come out more dirty. Gurudev used to give this example, that when he had taken sannyas, his teacher, Swami Tapovan, had advised him to walk right up to the tip of South India alone. And he said that you are not to sleep in anybody's house. You will sleep under a tree or in a temple. Thirdly, you will not take a lift from anybody, even when it is offered. Gurudev used to say, he knew my mischievous mind, that I will take a lift. And then I said, no, Swamiji, I never asked for it. I was just offered. So I took it. So he emphasized this, that not even when it is offered. So you will just walk right down till there. Now walking, so Gurudev did it, you know, and he walked right down till the tip of South India on his feet, on his, you know, walking alone on his feet. So he used to get dirty and he used to look for some place where he could have a bath. Obviously, he couldn't go into anybody's house to have a bath. So he used to find a pond somewhere or a lake or a river or a stream where he could bathe his tired legs and body. So he gave this example. He said that once he saw a pond and he was so tired and hungry and dirty that he said, let me quickly jump into this and have a bath. He says, I jumped into that water. And even while I was bathing, I thought that the water was a little slimy. And when I came out of it, I was full of muck and dirt and cow dung. Because he came to know later that that was the pond in which all the local buffaloes of the village used to take a bath. So Gurudev came out dirtier than what he was when he went in. And he says, we all do this in our daily lives. We go to exhaust a vasana. And the example, another example is, you go to see a movie and you see you have this thing ticking in your mind, the desire. This movie. Everybody is saying you haven't seen it. Go and see. So you go, you make all the plans, you go to see that movie. During that movie, they show you 4 different trailers, isn't it? And in those trailers, when you see, your eyes have already imbibed vasanas. You have already started thinking, after this, I will see this one, and then this one, and then this one. So rather than exhausting the desire, you have come back with more desires. A lady goes to buy one sari, and in the bargain, she sees 10 more very nice ones. So she must have them. So the next trip to the same shop is for those saris. I know a lady who went to a shop in Bangalore to buy some saris. And those saris were so appreciated by her friends that now her only desire is to go to Bangalore, to go to that particular shop and get more saris from there. So where do the desires, what is the method of extinguishing the desires? What is the method of feeling fulfilled? And so he, that is the question in Arjuna's mind, and Arjuna is looking at his teacher to give that answer. The teacher, from the face of the students, can make out that they have not understood. There is a blank look on their face, or there is a questioning look on their faces. So now he says, now for him who knows not the self, it is not right to neglect the duty enjoined on him. So see, everybody is not a realized master. In fact, they are a very rare few who are. So to all the rest, action is advised. Get this very clear. This Neshkarmya is there only for the realized master, the Siddha Purush, the man of wisdom. Only he can sit still without working. That is the ultimate for him. But for people like you and me, we are to nicely into action, nicely into the world, nicely into acquisition, possession of objects. And so actionlessness is never advised to us by Krishna. And now look what he says. Karmendriyani sayamya yaaste manasa smaran indriyat indriyarthan vimudhatma mithyachara sa uchyate. Very interesting. Karmendriyani sayamya. Sayam, you know, understand sayam? So controlling the karma indriyas, indriyas of action, your limbs of action, controlling them, sayam, controlling them, ya aste, he who sits, aste, sits, manasasmaran. But what does he do? He sits quietly, controlling his limbs of action, but manasasmaran, he is remembering all the actions that he wants to do. And all the actions that he desires to do. This is the state of all of us, isn't it? We sit in the puja room, controlling our eyes. We close our eyes. We close the room. No noise. All the staff in the house is told, nobody should make any noise. I am doing my dhyan. And what is the dhyan? The dhyan, manasa smaran. Manasa smaran of all the thoughts that you go, all your desires. Today I'm going to do this. Today I'm going to do this. I have to do this. I have to do this. Now, indriyarthan vimudhatma. Mithyachara sochate. Such a man is called mithyachari. Mithyachari means a hypocrite. So these are all galis given to us, actually, by Krishna, that you are a mithyachari. You sit in your puja room thinking of all kinds of things that you can do and all kind of acquisitions that you can get. So you are sa mithyachara sa uchyate. He is called a mithyachari. He is a stupid fool, Gurudev used to say. Why does he say stupid fool? See, vimudhatma. Mudha is a fool. And vimudha, Gurudev used to say, he who excels in foolishness. So you are a vimudha and a mithyachari. Look at the words Krishna is using for a person like us. That, you know, we are an... Gurudev used to say that if while you are doing your puja, if somebody takes a secret video recording of your mind, you know, you cannot show it to anybody. You really cannot show it to anybody. Think about it. Because all kind of thoughts, even vulgar thoughts which you never otherwise think about, come into your mind. Violent thoughts come into your mind. How would you like to beat your neighbor at night, putting a blanket on him? Those plans are going on. And you are sitting in the puja room, trying to think of the Lord. So such a person is called Vimudhatma, and a mithyachari. How to teach my upstairs neighbor a lesson? He troubles me. I can't sleep at night. These children keep running about up and down. And the result is we sleep late and we get up late. Every day I have to teach him a lesson. How do I teach? And that plan you are generating in the puja room while meditating. And many people, you know, come out with this. In my meditation, I got this bright idea. How come you got the bright idea while meditating? That means you were not even meditating. You cannot get a bright idea while meditating. You cannot get an inspiration while meditating. I know people who have even told me how their business problems are solved while meditating. Very nice. So, you know, this is us. Keep remembering sense objects by showing to the world that you are meditating. Now I'm reading the translation. He who restraining the organs of action sits thinking in his mind of the sense objects, he of deluded understanding is called a hypocrite. This is the biography of you and me. Such people are advised not to meditate. Such people are advised action. If you are sitting there all the time, you are only thinking of other things, then why are you even trying to meditate? Don't do it, because your mind is not meditation worthy. You have not reached that equipoise of mind, that calmness of mind, where it becomes a fit instrument for meditation. It cannot meditate. Gurudev used to say that for people like us, when you try meditating, even if for 5 minutes you can hold your mind, then meditate. But if even for 5 minutes your mind is not still, then don't do it, please. And for such people, Gurudev's recommendation used to be that open your eyes and sit with a jap mala. Go on chanting the Lord's name and look at your Ishta Devata. That will help you to focus your mind on him, and your mind will run less outside. You will not think of plans and things, of doing all kind of things. You will concentrate on the Lord. Talk to the Lord, if nothing else. Emote to the Lord. Tell him your problems. Plead with him. Surrender to him. That is the kind of puja which is advised to somebody who cannot control his mind. So don't just do it as a kind of a thing. Everybody thinks that, Gurudev used to say, that you think that once you sit in the puja room, you have done your duty for the day. It is a kind of thing, ke haan ji, maine kar liya. And you think that you are an angel or you are a Buddha in the making. Some people... You will be surprised that some people, even with Gurudev, used to act this whole thing out, that I am almost reaching. You know, Swamiji, I have to almost reached. And Gurudev used to show them in one straight go that you have reached nowhere. This is not an easy game. It's a very, very difficult thing to control the mind. And therefore, it says that you cannot physically sit quiet, but mentally be agitated in your puja room. Or even he says, first act in the world with a peaceful mind. Practice that. People want to jump straight into meditation. You cannot. You first practice being calm and peaceful and agitationless in the working world outside. Do your actions in a cool, collected, equipoised manner. And gain that equipoise through your actions. So physical repression will always cause a reversal of the mind. If you physically control yourself and physically also stubbornly calm your mind, some people try to do that, Hatha Yoga, practices of Hatha Yoga, they try to do that. And that will not calm your mind, but there will be a burst of the mind into a lot of activity, a lot of anger sometimes, a lot of emotional outbursts many times, because that is a suppression. It is not an overcoming of vasanas or growing beyond desires. It is a suppression, forceful suppression of the body and the mind. Indriyarthe vimudhatma. Indriyarthan vimudhatma. He says that suppressing the mind and the sense objects purposely will not allow you to meditate. Now, see over here. He says that generally we give a show of morality, whereas our minds are most of the time thinking of immoral actions and also thinking of ignoble actions, thinking of violent thoughts. So all these kind of thoughts that are centered in the body and centered in your interaction with other people's body is on a seeker's mind. This is not a seeker. This is not a seeker. This is a man of the world. And you and I are men of the world. And therefore, action is advised to us. Not sitting in your puja room, pretending to meditate. You cannot order your mind into silence. The mind is agitated. The mind is jumping. The mind wants to gain this, that, and the other. Then go and do it. But practice only the elementary step. And the elementary step is calming your mind while acting in the world. So that is the first step. Don't jump into meditation. And so then Gurudev used to say that you are at the moment a shackled slave of the mind. Your body will be dictated by the mind, not the other way around. Meditation is the other way around. That is that your mind dictates your body and the body listens. When I say the body, it means the gross body and the subtle body together is in your control. Only such a person can rise in meditation. Otherwise, all the others are called Vimudatma and Mithyachari. And let us be honest about it. We all fall into this category. And as I said, that this is our biography, each one of us. So we can sit, we can close our eyes, we can close the doors, we can silence every place, but the mental bondage has not gone. You know, you are bound by the mind, you are a slave to the mind, and the mind drags you by the hair, here, there, and everywhere, and you are helpless. To such a man, and let us accept this, that this is us. This is us. We are a deluded hypocrite, as Gurudev calls us. And so, let us not do something like this. Now, then we come to the next verse.
Yastvindriyani manasa niyamyarabhatirjuna karmendriye karma yogam asakta savishishyate.
He says, but whosoever controlling the senses by the mind, O Arjuna, engages his organs of action in karma yoga without attachment, he excels. Now, from here on is the advice to people like Arjuna, and Arjuna represents us. He is a person, human being like us. I've told you again and again that he is a prince. And he has desires maybe more multiplied than what we have. So the karma yoga advice, the advice for doing action is to Arjuna, not Naishkarmyam. Naishkarmyam is a goal indicated. It is not advice to people like you and me. Once you can control the mind, the sense organs get controlled automatically. So the main thing is to control the mind. How does one control the mind? Now then, how does one control the mind? See, through action. Gurudev used to say that through single pointed action, focusing your mind on the action that you are doing, you will be able to control the mind. Some people use concentrating on the breath. I would only say that concentrate on the action you are doing. And that is Karma Yoga. The examples Gurudev used to give was a scientist in his lab. A scientist in his lab who's totally engrossed into his work, into the experiment he is doing, or a mathematician who is trying to solve a problem, right? A discoverer who's almost at the edge of his discovery, almost there. How concentrated is his mind? And he is acting with full concentration. He has forgotten to eat. He has forgotten to sleep. He has forgotten that he has a family. He has forgotten that he has a body. That kind of concentrated action is called Karma Yoga. See, that when his mind is so concentrated, the body automatically calms down. Sense organs calm down. They also, so these are the one example Gurudev very often used to give. Let me quote that. That is, women in Rajasthan, you know, do not have water in their villages. So they have to walk miles and miles to fetch water. So they generally make it like a social club. It is the kitty party kind of a thing. So four or five women get together, and they have these one pot after the other, sometimes even four or five pots on their head, and they go to fetch water. Now these four or five women walking very gracefully, very colorful clothes that Rajasthani women wear, and they are chatting and gossiping about their mother-in-law and sister-in-law and this one and that one and the problems and what have they cooked and their children and all that. They go gossiping to the riverfront, which is miles away, or a well or a lake or a pond, which is miles away. There they go and fill up water. Now they have these loads of pots on their head, right? But if you observe them, they are walking, giggling, laughing, talking, gossiping, but totally their head is erect all the time, and one part of their brain is totally concentrated that the pot should not fall. Not one pot, but pot after pot on their head. So they are constantly aware of that, that this is the goal for which I went all the way, to fetch water for my family. So this pot should not fall. And they totally are concentrated on that, though they are doing everything else. Similar is Karma Yoga. Karma Yoga can effectively be done only when you are doing everything else in life, all your actions, fulfill your desires. You can do whatever else you like, but your devotion to that altar should not waver. Any action you are doing should become a ritual. It should become a puja. It should become a surrender to the Lord. It should be that I am doing this as a gift for my Lord. Let me do it beautifully. And let me do it all the time thinking of Him, that this is my gift to Him. Let it be the best. So all your actions will be perfect, and there will be peace and beauty descended on your mind. And that will be Karma Yoga. Look, again I will read, but whosoever controlling the senses by the mind, O Arjuna, see, controlling the senses by the mind, O Arjuna, engages his organs of action in Karma Yoga. Now there are two things advised here. The mind has to be controlled so that it concentrates on the action you are doing. Right? So, and By that, he engages his organs of action in Karma Yoga. That means his body is working and the sense organs are concentrated on the action that the body is doing. So that means total concentration, absolute concentration. And that is what Karma Yoga is about. Offering my action to the Lord, doing it selflessly, without ego, egocentric desires. Totally into action, concentrated action, but without attachment to the result. No attachment to the result. See, karma yogam asakta. Karma yoga should be asakta means detached, without asakti, without attachment, unattached, asakta. Sa visheshyate. He excels in the action. This is the secret of excelling in action. Even a student who is totally concentrated on his studies. Studying is an action, right? But his mind controls his sense organs and his sense organs control the body. So the body is sitting motionless. The sense organs are totally concentrated on his studies. And when he studies like that, for hours together on his work, on the work the teacher has given him, or any project he is working on, the student will excel. Look at the word visheshyate. Visheshyate means he excels in his work. Nothing can stop you if your mind and your body is totally concentrated. But not like today's children listening with ear pods, studying also, and the music is going on and they have those those earphones on their ears and they're listening to music while studying. Now, where is their mind? Is it on the music or is it on the book that they are studying? Cannot be. Their attention is already divided. So unfocused attention will not allow you to excel ever. And therefore, this multitasking does not reach you to perfection. There should be no multitasking. All your mental energies should be concentrated onto one single point. And it is only then that you will excel. Niyatam kuru karma tvam karma jayo hya karmanaha. Sharira yatra pichate na prasidhyeda karmanaha. The translation is, do you perform your bounden duty, for action is superior to inaction. Even the maintenance of the body would not be possible for you by inaction. See, this is the advice given to us. Inaction is not advice to us. As I said right in the beginning of the talk today, that inaction is not our cup of tea. He says that with inaction, you cannot even maintain your body. Isn't that right? Because inaction means total inaction. No eating, no drinking, nothing. You are not even conscious of the body. So, actionlessness, in actionlessness, man's efficiency and skill becomes zero. Man must work. He is made to work. But how should he work? That is noble actions, selfless actions, which benefit society. And with total concentration when he works then. So look what he says, niyatam kuru karma. Niyatam means prescribed duty. Those actions that are niyat. Niyati means they are prescribed to you. Niyatam kuru karma. Karmatvam. Karma jayo hya karmanaha. Bounden duty is superior to inaction. Now, what is the bounden duty? Harmoniously living in your family with all is your social duty. Not only with family, with outsiders also, living harmoniously is social duty. and niyatam is obligatory duties of every day that you do. See, there are these four listed over here. Number one, daily duties, which are nitya karma. B, duties that are to be undertaken on special occasions, that is naimitya karma. And special rituals propitiating the necessary cosmic power, the deity, by the invocation of which, some specific desires are to be fulfilled. That is kamya karma. And lastly, deeds and behaviors which are declared as immoral and undivine, nishiddha karma. So these are the four categories of karmas given out in the Vedas, which he is listing to you for your information. So these are the Vedic definition of karma. Mostly they are social obligations and personal obligations. Nitya karma is every day. What you do every day, eating, drinking, bathing, cleansing yourself, all this cleansing your whole body, these are nitya karma. Okay. Now the other ones which are undertaken on special occasions are the naimitya karmas. Special occasions, duties. Somebody, there is a wedding in the family, they have called you. You must go. You know, social duties that you have. Some people say, no, I won't fulfill. If you are living in the society, you must fulfill those duties. Those are a must. You know, because you give and take, you live by give and take in the society. It cannot be, if you don't care for others, others don't care for you. So it is advised in the Vedas, naimitya karma are duties. Somebody's child is born, he is given a feast, you must go and wish, you must attend. Somebody called you for some puja in the house, go and attend, even if for a short while. So that when you are doing all those, these are naimitya karmas, aap bhi kabhi kaba karenge, sometimes you do this, so they are not every day. Then special rituals propitiating cosmic powers for the invocation of those powers so that your desires are fulfilled. You know, havans are done. As I told you some time back, that havans and mantras are done, pujas are done, for propitiating that particular power which will grant you your desire. That is called kamya karma. All those are kamya karma, actions that give you. And the last is nishiddha karma. Nishiddha karma are immoral actions, actions that are not advised at all. So such actions should not be done. They are a total no-no advised by the Vedas because they will have very bad effects on you. Uska jo pratyavaya hai, jo aapke upar aayega, karma phal jo aapke upar aayega, that is going to be extremely bad. So this is here. This much you must understand by this, that you perform bounden duty. Whatever is your duty, do it. Without doing action, you cannot live. In short, this is what this verse is saying. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamadachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti 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 Hari Om. Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Hari Om.